This conference will now be recorded.
So yesterday we understood what is k nearest neighbors, and today we're gonna begin with something known as Apriori algorithm. Now this is kind of a data mining technique. So typically when there are a lot of records in your data set, so there are some records which are quite frequent, right? We say them as frequent item sets, and they may have some, you know, rules through which they are associated to each other. Once again, we're again working mathematically, right? So you guys would have seen when you are purchasing something on Amazon or Flipkart as an e-commerce, right, platform, you're trying to buy one product. So while your purchase, Amazon or Flipkart will suggest that often people also buy this another product along with this product which you're going to buy. So you buy both and you try to save money, correct? So this is the kind of, you know, you can say solution which we are going to, you know, design with the help of a priori algorithm. So you wanna come up and see some, you know, a data set, how the customers are going to buy the products, how frequently they are going to buy the products, and what are the association rules when multiple customers buy the similar item sets, you know, together or again and again. So in the a priori algorithm, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna understand it as a data mining technique. So we are trying to basically see our data set, and there are some association rules which we are going to, you know, identify. So guys, these association rules can be understood by the help of an example. So there is a customer who wants to buy, you know, a product on the e-commerce platform. So you have to come up and find some correlations and associations between different items that customers place in their shopping cart, and we will be able to derive some recurring patterns. Okay, so let me put it in a more easier example. Let's say as a shopping cart platform, right, any e-commerce platform, customer is gonna buy a phone cover, so he also grabs a screen guard, right? So I want to buy a phone cover, and I'm also planning, okay, if I change my phone cover, I'll also change my screen guard, right? So platform's gonna analyze that, shopping cart platform, e-commerce platform, right? So these people will analyze what you're buying, right? So it's not only that customer A will do the same, right? There may be a customer B will also do the same. So people often tend to buy cover and guards together. So that's the kind of an association which, you know, platform will start to arrange the data sets to mine this kind of a, you know, pattern. And thereafter, anytime if you're gonna buy a certain, you know, screen guard or let's say phone cover, so platform gonna suggest you, okay, you buy them together, and there may be a noticeable increase in the sales. So this process of identifying an association between the products and the items is known as association rule mining, and this is why a priori algorithm is used for. So this is one algorithmic approach, right? So it's not an ML model, you can't find it in sklearn. So in the a priori algorithm, so algorithm shall assume that any subset of a frequent item set must be frequent. So let us say that there is a transaction, right? And this transaction is that a person is going to buy cover, guard, and power bank, right? So this is one set. Three products, a set of three products now, right? Now this set also contains cover and guard. Now if there are frequent transactions, if there are frequent certain transactions, right? So according to the principle of a priori, if cover guard power bank is frequent, then cover and guard must also be frequent. So guys, can I get an acknowledgement as a smiley from all of you? Is this clear? What is a priori algorithm? All right, guys. So let's proceed. So how will this a priori algorithm work? So the key concept in a priori algorithm is that it assumes all the subsets of a frequent item set to be frequent. Similarly, for any infrequent item set, all its supersets must also be infrequent. So I'm gonna show you a data set, right? So we'll be trying to work on this data set and understand that how a priori algorithm can work. So this is a data set where we have these six transactions. So ID is 1 to 6. So you got cover, guard, power bank, and the charger, right? So let's say these are the four products which customers basically, you know, buy frequently. We are just assuming this now on any e-commerce platform with respect to your mobile purchases. So zeros is like in the transaction that product wasn't purchased. So in the first transaction, you got all the four things purchased by one customer. Second transaction, your guard was missing. Third transaction, your cover and guard was missing, but power bank and charger were bought together, right? So certainly this is the kind of data set, right, which we got with ones and zeros. So for a priori algorithm, we are assuming this data set of six transactions, and we're gonna evaluate certain parameters on which we are going to work. So we can find multiple rules from the scenario. For example, in a transaction of cover, guard, and power bank, if cover and guard are bought, then customers also buy power bank. So this is the kind of a rule, association rule, right, which we are deriving from the behaviors. So in case the transaction has cover and guard, then there is a likelihood that customer can also buy a power bank, or it can be the other way around, but this all can be derived only by looking into your data sets. So in order to select the interesting rules out of these various, you know, transactions, we have these four different patterns, mathematical formulas, you can say the measures to derive these rules. You have support, confidence, list, and conviction. So guys, these are the four parameters on which we have to work, and let's see one by one how they can be used, and we can work on them. Now, support of the item X is the ratio of the number of transactions in which the item X appears to the total number of transactions. So we are saying support of cover is 4 by 6. Now, in order to make this more comfortable, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come here and write this new Python file. So let us say one new Python file. This is your session number 49. So a priori, let's say, algorithm. So you're going to come up and consider this data set. So just give me a moment. So guys, this is the data set which we will be considering to evaluate various association rules between them. And this is the kind of, you can say, transactions which the customer has made on the e-commerce platform. All right. So this is the data set. And on this particular data set, how you have to work, now you're going to see that. Okay. So there are four measures, right, which you should be working on with respect to this scenario. The very first one is support. So how you can evaluate support, right? So let us say you want to evaluate a support of something known as cover, right? So what is the support of cover in the data set, right? So as per the mathematical measure, it says number of transactions in which the cover appeared. So number of transactions in which cover appeared, then divided by, so you're gonna divide it by total transactions. So anytime if you are going to follow this support of cover or any other attribute, so you count, so this cover is transacted 1, 2, 3, and 4 out of 6, right? So it's like 4 by 6, so which is certainly something like 0.66. So can I get an acknowledgement from all of you? Did you understand the very first measure, the first, you can say, parameter by which you can actually extract association rules, right? So support is your first parameter. After the support, we got something known as confidence. Now confidence, X implies Y. What exactly is mean, right? So this signifies the likelihood of the item Y being purchased when the item X is purchased. So confidence is the parameter which is going to yield the result that, of course, the customer may buy your product Y in case the product X is being transacted. So now the confidence of cover and guard bought together, and the likelihood of power bank we have to evaluate, right? So this is exactly, Sarthak, exactly. So this is conditional probability only, guys, right? At the end of the day, what you did in our Navy base part. So confidence of cover and guard that customer's gonna come up with the power bank. So it is going to be support of cover, guard, and the power bank divided by support of cover and guard. So let us try to see how we are going to come up and, you know, derive this confidence. So I want to come up and find the confidence. So confidence is like cover and guard purchase together. So you're gonna come up and say cover and guard purchase together. What is the likelihood of that we are going to buy this power bank? So how you will evaluate this? To evaluate this, you need to come up and find the support for cover, guard, and the power bank. Then you divide by support of cover and guard. So this is what the formula shall come up, and you know, we are going to use it. So let us see, guys, how you will be evaluating this part here. So what is your support for cover, guard, and power bank? So when you say cover, guard, and power bank bought together, so I think these are two transactions, transaction one, transaction two, right? So 2 by 6, then you divide this number by support of cover and guard bought together. 1, 2, and 3. So you're gonna divide it by 3 by 6. Makes a sense to everyone? Can I get a smiley from all of you? So this is nearly 0.66 again. Exactly, exactly, Manmeet, right. So this is your second parameter called confidence, which we have to explore. After the confidence, you have this third parameter called lift. Okay, Sarthak says, please explain again. So Sarthak, confidence of cover and guard, right? Likelihood for purchasing the power bank is gonna be support of cover, guard, and power bank as bought together, divided by the support of cover and guard. All right. So how you calculate the support? Number of transaction divided by total transaction. So cover, guard, and power bank is coming up only in these two transactions. So all bought together, right? So one and number five. So there are only two transactions. So it's 2 by 6, and you're going to divide it by 3 by 6 because cover and guard is occurring 3 times. All right, great. So next is where we're going to understand what is meant by lift. So when I say lift, X implies Y, right? So it is interestingness or the likelihood of the item Y being purchased when the item X is sold. So there's a difference. There's a very, you know, a quite difference when it comes to your confidence versus lift, right? So lift is working when your item is already sold, right? So unlike confidence, this method takes into account the popularity of item Y. So you are trying to understand how much an item Y is popular. So lift of cover guard implies power bank, right? So this is the interestingness or the likelihood of the power bank being purchased when the cover and guard is sold. Can I get a smiley again from everyone? Is the lift parameter clear to everyone? Wonderful. So yes, Navjot, you can please see what is the lift parameter here. Number 3 is this lift. So I want to evaluate lift of, let's say, cover and guard for the power bank. Now this is all about customer purchasing power bank when cover and guard is sold to the customer, right? So this is a likelihood where customer will buy the power bank along with the cover and guard. This is the likelihood customer will buy the power bank after the cover and guard has been sold. Good to go, Navjot. Okay, so what this is going to be for us? This is going to be support of your cover, guard, and the power bank together. Right, so this is going to be support of cover bank, cover guard, and power bank together, divided by support of cover multiplied by support of guard. So this is going to be support of cover multiplied by support of guard. So what is the output here, guys? What is the output here when we'll solve this equation? acknowledgements awaited from all of you. So what's gonna be the output for this equation? So it's gonna be this we already know 2/6 divided by 3/6 into 4/6. I think this is the use case. So what is the support of cover? So cover is purchased. Okay, guard is 1, 2, 3, 4. So my bad. So just give me a moment. So it's 4/6 into 4/6, I think. Is this the case for everyone? All right, so this is coming up as something like 0.77 for us. Now, typically, we say the lift of X implies Y. If it is equal to 1, right? If this is equal to 1, so no correlation. So there is no correlation. If your value is greater than 1, so this is meant by a positive correlation. And if it is less than 1, it means there is a negative correlation. So this is a negative correlation, unlikely to be bought, right? So this is likely to be bought. And when I say no correlation, right, it means do not consider. So you have to consider only one case that is greater than 1, right? So for us, this will matter a lot, right? So this is the case for which we are going to be happy. So you find this lift, and this is how you can actually, you know, kind of work on one more parameter, one more correlations. The fourth one is conviction. Let us see what is meant by the conviction. Conviction is defined as, you can say, it's a rule, right? Which will have one more relationship, but I'll come up and tell you what exactly will it do after this formula is applied. So when I say conviction of X implies Y, it is 1 minus support of Y divided by 1 minus of confidence X implies Y, right? So first of all, let us apply this formula and then we will understand what exactly is the kind of this conviction rule. So conviction of, so I want to evaluate conviction of, let's say, this cover and guard. So this implying the power bank, right? The same thing which we are doing, we want to come up and see the conviction here. So what is the formula for conviction? It is 1 minus support of the power bank. Right, so this is 1 minus support of power bank divided by 1 minus confidence of cover and guard, implying the power bank. So what's gonna be the output, guys, here? So 1 minus what divide by 1 minus what? So these two question marks, what will be the value, guys? Support of power bank, right? So here you are. So it's gonna be support of power bank is gonna be 4/6. I think this is clear. So what is confidence of your cover guard and the power bank, right? So this was coming as 0.66 for us, and this was also 0.66. so 1 minus 0.66, or you can say 1 minus 4/6, right, divided by 1 minus this 2/6 divided by 3/6. So this is what the exact situation is. So this will come out to be nearly 1 or so. So when I say conviction, so conviction with the value coming as 1, right? So if the conviction x employing y is equal to 1, so we say that x has no relation with y. X has no relation with y. So greater than, so the case is once again conviction should come greater than 1. So more the value, so higher the interest, right? So more the value, higher the interest of being purchased, or product being purchased, or item being purchased. Yes, so nearly 1 exactly, Shashi. So guys, can I get a smiley here? So are these 4 different rules clear to everyone? So we can apply these 4 rules, and thereafter we can anytime come up and see what is the correlation with different attributes, different you know parameters being purchased here and there. So this is what Apriori algorithm is, and this is how it's gonna work for us. Now we have one more way of dealing with it. So let us say I'm gonna write a frequency table. So you write a frequency table. In the frequency table, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna calculate number of times the item is appearing in transaction. So cover appears 4 times, guard appears 4 times, power bank appears 4 times, and charger appears 5 times, right? So I'm gonna write this frequency table for items. So I'm just gonna share this, so much of this part over the chat. If you want, you can just reuse the same for your referral discussions. So you have this item. So I got this cover, guard, then the power bank, and lastly we have this charger. So these are the 4 items, right? And we have a frequency of their occurrence. So cover appears 4 times, guard is 4 times, power bank is 4, charger is 5. Now looking on to this table, right, you can very easily say that okay, charger is the product which is sold more often, right, as compared to the other products, right? Now I'm going to derive one more frequency table, right, and we are going to consider the value for support as threshold be 3. So with this, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna write a frequency table once again. So this frequency table is going to work very well for us. We need to assume support threshold as 3. So this frequency table actually is following that threshold value 3. Let's say we are going to consider this value 3 as in greater than or equal to, right? So cover is greater than 4, guard is greater than 4, power bank greater than, 3 is 4 greater than 3, all of them are greater than 3. Let us try to make pairs now. Let's make pairs. So I want to make the pairs for these items, right? So I want to see cover and guard together. Then I'm gonna come up and say cover and power bank together. Then I'm gonna say cover and charger together. Then let's say your guard and power bank together. Then we got this guard and let's say charger. Done the power bank, let's say guard and the power bank, guard and the charger. And lastly, let's say power bank and the charger. So guys, what is the frequency of their occurrence from the table? So what is the frequency of occurrence? So let's see cover and guard coming together, right? So cover and guard 1, 2 and 3. So 3 times cover and guard was purchased together. Next is your cover and power bank. So cover and power bank 1, 2. Then once again this parameter 3. So the frequency comes out to be 3, right, for this case. Then I'm gonna assume this cover and charger together. So cover and charger 1, 2, 3 and 4. So cover and charger together were purchased as in 4 times. Then we got the guard and the power bank. So 1 and 2. So guard and the power bank are being purchased only 2 times. So guard and the charger, right? So guard and the charger 1. Then you got 2 and 3. So 3 times. So last is your power bank and charger. So power bank and charger is 1, 2, 3 and 4, 4 times. So this is like what you are doing is we are trying to make a frequency table and thereafter we are trying to analyze how the things can be done for us. Right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna consider the support threshold to be greater than 3. If I consider support threshold to be greater than 3, so I only get 2 of the items through which we can understand that okay, they are bought together. So remember, when we are trying to come up and understand the support as parameter, it is the only simple concept, number of transaction, right, divided by total transactions. So this is how you can do a correlation, right? You can find the relationships. Okay, how many times, what items being, you know, bought together, this, that, blah, 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 right? We can even work for 3 of the pairs, right? So if you wanna come up and a pair 3, let's say you wanna pair this cover, then your guard and the charger, right? So this is 1, 1, 1. Then 1, this is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 and 1. So 3 times cover, guard and charger. So if you consider the threshold value as equal to 3, right, greater than equal to 3, so you get these 3 coming up together. So these are the various correlations which you can find through frequency tables as well, right? So a very simple understanding on how a priori algorithm is, how it can work. So anyone finding any challenge here can please raise the query now. Are we clear till here, guys? I'll just ping this part over the chat in case we are good to go. So a smiley waited as an acknowledgement from all of you in case we are good to go, guys. All right, so what I got next is this file called transactions.csv. So what we see that there are these, let it be 21 records of transactions. So I just created these as some of the records here, right? So let's say 22, or you can just have it for some 30 days. So 1 to 30, right? So you got 1 month transactions over the 4 products, right? Is the data set clear to everyone? Can I get a smiley from all of you? Right. Now let us come here and say import pandas as PD, and thereafter what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say data frame is your PD dot read a CSV file called transactions dot CSV, right? So let's thereafter print this data frame. So you run the program. So you get this data set, but what we see is the first record is considered as the header, right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say header is none. So I don't want any header. So it will give me this 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4 as these 5 columns. So whatsoever the value is not available, right? So it is coming as NaN for us, right? So the data is not available here, the missing values. Now the next thing what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna say print me the shape of data frame. So it says the shape is 30, 5, right? What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to now convert the data frame as list of lists. So a simple Python list of lists, right? So it means I can even skip this pandas code. I can simply write my file IO read operation. So read the lines and make a line of lines, right? But let's see how I'm gonna do this. So I'm gonna say lines, or the better term for this maybe a data is a list. So we got a list of records, right? So let it be records. So there is a list of records, right, in your file. So I'm gonna say for I in range. So guys, this range should work till 30, right? Because this is the length of your kind of data set from 0 to 29. So I'm iterating here, right? 0 to 29. So other way around, I can say df dot shape of 0, right? So this loop's gonna run 30 times from 0 to 29, right? So I'll just try to come up and say print I here. So what you will see, okay, I got an error here. That's a great check for us. So here we are. 0 to 29, this loop will run, right? Now in this loop, I will use a list comprehension. I'll say records dot append, but append what? So your data frame dot values of, let us say, ith value, then the jth component, and this I'm gonna do. All right, so this is your, I'm gonna convert it into string. Let us see a list comprehension for j in range. So this was your data frame shape of 1. So this df dot shape of 1. So I'm using this list comprehension. So let us try to say print the records. So what you see is we converted every record into a generator object. If you can recall the Python generator part, right? And now the next thing is, so guys, this is kind of a list of lists for us, where every single record for me is going to be one of the generator objects, right? So this is list of lists being a generator as one object. So generator we did when we understood the term of yield, right? When we understood what is meant by that term called yield. So I think I can do it in a better way. So just give me a moment, rather than creating this list of lists. So just give me a moment. I'll make it more simplified for all of you. You guys should not get confused. All right, I think this is more convenient for all of you. Can I get a smiley as an acknowledgement? So what I did, I actually iterated in this data frame, ith row, jth column, and I got a complete row as one list, and this is your list of lists, right? More convenient. So you just got this list of lists now. Now for a priori model, I can not work with sklearn. Sklearn will not give me that algorithm. So we have a separate library, right? So this library I'm just going to put up here. So I'll say from apriori import a priori. So guys, you need to install this library called apriori. So this works as in your pip install apriori, right? So in order to work with a priori algorithm, you just come up and create this, I mean install this library. Now what we can do is we can find the association rules which can be, you know, kind of this a priori for us. So you pass the records, then you pass some parameters, right? For example, what is the value of minimum support, confidence, and the lift, right? So what do you want as in their minimum values to be? So for minimum support, I'm going to choose the threshold as 0.50. It is up to you. You can change these values and try to find the correlations. Then let's say the minimum lift is, I'm choosing it as 1. Then I'm gonna say minimum confidence is going to be, let us say 0.7, because for us, I think, so the order can be anything. I'm just putting up in this manner. So these are the list of lists which is available as data set. This is the minimum support, minimum confidence, and minimum lift on which I would like to work, right? And there may be another parameter called minimum length. So there may be this minimum underscore length. So just give me a moment. So at least we are looking forward for the relationship with at least two attributes, right? So minimum length. Now what I will do is print me the list of association rules. Let's try to run the program and see. So what we see is that a set of charger which can be bought alone, then we have these all relationships which will be coming up for us. So the cover being bought together, the guard. So you have this list of you can say association rules for every of your data set, right? What is what? So charger and cover being bought together, right? So this with this, this confidence with this list lift. So you get all these association rules automatically rather than you working on these parameters and thereafter working on the frequency tables. You can use this a priori as in your algorithm. So guys, can I get a smiley from all of you? Is this good to go? So we need not to write our own algorithm, and this can be automatically taken care of. So you need to just, you know, kind of work on real-time data sets, which may be more influential. And I know a lot of you are actually not into exploration of all those real-time data sets and all. So I would humbly request that everyone should try to find the data set on GitHub, get the better data sets and work on them, right? It's highly important that we just don't code this much. All right, so let's have a small break, and after the break we shall proceed further. So I have the next discussion with us called feature selection, which is also referred to as dimensionality reduction, and the feature extraction, right? So we got some APIs to explore in sklearn. So let's have a small break of 10 minutes and then we will explore them, guys, right? Let's have a small break. So guys, I'm back. I hope you can hear my voice and screen is visible to all. All right, guys. So now the next part of our discussion shall be how we're gonna work on feature selection or dimensionality reduction. And the other part of our discussion shall be feature extraction. Now, as the name suggests, right, feature selection or dimensionality reduction, right? Now, when you're working on large data sets, right, when you have a lot of dimensions, we try to say you have, let's say, n number of features where n is very high. So computationally, it's gonna be very much difficult on high dimensional data sets that you achieve the best performance. So what we can do is we can apply an algorithm to pre-process the data and ensure to kind of filter only those features which have more meaning for ML models. So we don't actually try to consider all the features. We consider some less features, optimal features to create our ML models, right? So feature extraction is another approach where you are trying to have a data set and you are trying to extract features out of it. You don't know features, you have the data set, but you extract the features, you make the features. So we have some built-in, APIs with the algorithmic approaches as by their names only. So there's a variance threshold. So we're gonna look for the variance, then select the k-best, select from a model, dictionary vectorizer. So this is very much similar to your one-hot encoder. Then you got this count vectorizer. So let's explore these, right? And see how we can code them. So I'm gonna write this new Python file. This is your session number 49A. So we're gonna work, we're gonna start with something known as feature selection. And also known as dimensionality reduction. So what is exactly this term called variance? So variance is basically quality of being different, right? It's a statistical term now. So what we are going to do is need to optimize our data set with only those features which are meaningful, that is contain more information. We want to optimize our data set, right? So this is our first part where why we want to come up and do this dimensional reduction. So this will variance, we'll just consider it very soon. So with the variance, when you say quality of being different, so what we will do is we shall remove all the features. So features means the attributes in your data set, right? Whose variance doesn't meet some threshold as specified by us. So you're gonna work on variance, right? And in case the variance will not meet the threshold as specified by us, it's gonna remove. For example, we have a data set with the features, and we want to consider and we wish to consider 80% of the samples, right? So for this part of it, so we have this API called variance threshold. So let me show you one demo on that. From sklearn dot feature selection, you say import variance threshold. Let us assume you got this X as a list. It's a list of lists, right? So you got multiple features now, 0, 0, and 1. So I'm trying to take this Boolean data, all right? So it means in our example, so we have a data set with Boolean features. So in our Boolean feature data set, I'm just going to make it something like 1, then zeros. Let's say 0, 1 and 1. So 0, 1, 0. And 0, 1, 1. So I've just made this small Boolean data set. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to say print me this X. So printing this X is going to be this list of lists. Now let's say variance of X is P into 1 minus P. So this is the formula, right, which is supposed to be applied. So when I say P into 1 minus P, so P is a threshold now. So I'll say reduction is a variance threshold. So there is reduction. Variance threshold is 80%, so I'll say 0.8 multiplied by 1 minus 0.8. Right, and then I'm gonna say your X now is reduction dot fit underscore transform this guy called X. So your data set is supposed to be transformed, right? And now if you will print back the X, so this is like print X before and this is your X after. So you run the program and okay, I think just give me a moment. So this didn't come out, just give me a moment. So this ideally should have reduced, you know, kind of the X data set for us. Why it didn't work for us? So I need to just cross check it once. No, Pradeep. So basically, we are reusing the same variable x. So guys, just try executing this program at your end. So I'm just gonna share this. So just give me a moment. We'll try to debug the same. All right, guys, so let's see now. So I just tried to redo the stuff. So here we are, right? So in the dimensionality reduction, what we can see is this was the data set before. So please try writing this code at your end in case you want. So I'm just sharing it over the chat. Ignore the first one. So this is the data set on which we are trying to work, right? So you got this a Boolean data set, zeros and ones, right? So as in your after part, what do you see is, so 001 converted to 01 only. 010 converted to 10. So zeros were being replicated, right? So 100 over here became 00. 011 became 11. Then 010 became 10 again, and 011 became 11 again, right? So whosoever was being replicated, that attribute is discarded. Can I get a smiley from all of you? Now this zero is coming twice in the data set. Why you want to have the same value two times, right? You have it one time. I would like to get one small acknowledgement from all of you. Let us see it on one more part, right? So I'm just gonna consider it in one more. So Neha, what we did, so you see this 001, right, as the first entry. Now zeros were coming two times. So we considered the zero only once, right? So before you add the data set in which you got three attributes, and after you are adding only two attributes. So you reduced down your data set with the help of this variance. So let us try to work with one more algorithm here. I mean another API. So session 49B. So let's say from sklearn.datasets import load iris. So we already know what is this iris data set, right? If you wanna see this iris data set, once again I can say x and y is your load iris. So there is one attribute called return xy, that's like true. So what we'll do is we'll directly have the values of x and y instead of having everything. So you can say print me x and print me y. So feature and the labels, right? So you get it in one single shot. So these are the list of features. And this is the list of your labels. Now, what we want to do is we want to apply dimensionality reduction on your data set. So we want consider only those features in your iris data set which are important and discard others. Correct? So before, let us say print x dot shape. Rather than printing this x and y, this already we know, I'm just going to print the shape of the x. It is 150 by 4, right? So we understand that there are 150 records and there are four features in the data set. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna use from sklearn dot feature selection, import select k best. So select the k best features, and from sklearn dot feature selection, import t square. So I hope you can recall, right, these k best and t square terms, right, in your previous discussions. So I'll say x underscore, or let's say x1 is select the k best with the t square, and let the k value be 2. And let the k value be 2. And this is one, let's say k best. Then I can say x1 is your k best dot fit underscore transform this x comma y. Now what we will do is we'll print down the shape of this guy called x1. So you run the program. My bad. So this is y. So what you see is the shape is 150 cross 2 now. So it means if I'm gonna print this x1, so there were two features in the iris data set which have been dropped. So you can train your model with the two features and the labels instead of four features and the labels, and hence the optimization is going to come up in a better way. So can I get an acknowledgement from all of you here? So guys, how we have implemented this dimensionality reduction? Did you understand the term dimensionality reduction? So Shimpa, if you can be more clearer about what topic you are asking your query for. In third list, output is not accordingly. So this is in context to which one? The previous one? So Shimpa, attribute with less information. For example, in this approach, right, in 001, since 0 is replicated, so it will be discarded. So there will be only 0 and 1. In the second sample, 010, so 0 is again replicated, so we'll have only 1 and 0. In third, you have 100, you have only two zeros, not one, right? So in 011, you have 11. In 010, you have 0 and 1, and 011, you have 11. So here is the output, right? I can share the output. You can please refer to the same, okay? All right, so we'll see one more API, the next API. So write a new Python file. This goes like session 49C. So guys, coming here, we are going to come up and work once again on the iris data set. So in future, you can have any of your data set, right? And once we'll have this, we can print the shape of X. So we know the shape of X is 150 by 4, right? So when I will say from sklearn.ensemble, you import extra tree classifier. Now this is another API, right? So we are going to use a random forest kind of learning technique, right? And now I'll say from sklearn dot feature selection, import select from model. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna create an ML model. From the ML model, we're gonna learn what features are required, what features are not required. So first of all, you create a model which is going to be this extra tree classifier with random forest approach, where we'll consider that there are 100 decision trees to make out on our data set, right? Because when you are working on your decision trees, that's the kind of a best examples to understand which attribute has more meaningful information, right? So you say model dot fit x comma y. So at the same time, right, now I'm going to say print me model dot feature importances. Let's see what we get as in your feature importances. So if you see the importance with respect to the features, right, so you get this 0.086, 0.052, 3847. So you understand which features they hold more importance in the percentage level. Now, what next we can do is we can say model is select from model, model comma predict assign true. Now this is your select from model SFM, right? So this is the object of this API select from model. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna say x1 is select from model dot transform this guy called x, and now let us say print us the x1, and I will also say print me x1 dot shape. So here we are with only two features, right, and this becomes 150 cross 2. So the features with more meaningful information will be automatically extracted and the others will be kind of gone. So Shashi, there are two zeros and one one, right? So it will show us 0 and 0, not 1 and 0. Okay, so what I can do is I'll understand. So what we'll do is we'll take down to that example in a different data set approach, right? I think that zeros and 1 is confusing for us. We'll take down to some different data set example. So guys, this is what we got as in your dimensionality reductions, right? So typically the dimensionality reductions, they work to reduce down the features in your data set, right? So we work on the dimensionality reductions to work on the data set optimization so that your model in future takes less time and do the computation, and this comes as a part of pre-processing of your data set. So one more which I have to take up is feature extraction now. So let's write a new Python file. This is your session number 49D. So there are some measurements. So let's say there are some weathers. We have a list of weather, right, and we have some city as the key in the dictionary, and let's say the value for the city is Delhi, and we have another key called temperature for which the value is let's say 33 degrees. Let's say 23.0. So I'm gonna write these few iterations here. Let's have three different cities. So Delhi, Mumbai, and Pune. So different temperature versions for three different cities. Let's say 12.0, let's say 18.0, right? And I'm just gonna print these three different weathers. So here we are as a list of dictionary. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say from sklearn dot feature extraction. So this is not selection, right? Extraction, import dictionary vectorizer. So you say vectorizer is an object of dictionary vectorizer. So this I'll just try to import in the head only. So we created an object of dictionary vectorizer. And thereafter, what I will do is I will say vectorizer dot fit underscore transform these weather records or the weather information. And thereafter, we will also convert it to array. We'll say a function called to array, and you will get an array as a result, right? So let us try to print this array. So guys, when you see this array, what you understand is 10033010120018. So typically your data set which had this, you know, words, they are now converted into numbers. And this is very much kind of your one hot encoding scheme, if you can recall, which we did in our previous structure, right? So I'll next say feature names is your vector dot get the feature names, and let us print these feature names. So what it did, it converted your feature names, that's like your city as Delhi, city as Mumbai, city as Pune, and the temperature into the corresponding zeros and ones. So one hot model is one of the kind of a technique, right, which this API dictionary vectorizer will automatically do, but your data set must be in a dictionary format. So guys, there is one more API associated with it. So this is known as count vectorizer, right? So please explore the same. So this is going to work if you have this kind of, you can say, sentences, and you want to count the number of words in it, right? So a very beautiful implementation. So what I'll do is I'll just try to write a small program on that as well for you people. Just give me a moment. It may be a useful tip. I have a kind of, you know, some surety that you guys may not do it, and it's a bit important here. So there is this sklearn dot feature extraction dot text, from where I'm going to import this API called count vectorizer, right? So there is this vectorizer object, count vectorizer object, which I have created. So if you'll just print this guy called count vectorizer, so you get to see that count vectorizer is going to analyze the words, right? It's gonna encode UTF-8, right? So lowercase will be converted, your words will be converted to lowercase, and then it's gonna see there are some stop words, there is some pre-processing. So these are the default attributes which are already, you know, enabled while you will be working on your textual data, right? So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna come up and create a list of some sentences, right? So some sentences. Now this list of sentences is like what? You can read these sentences from a file. So the first sentence is, this is the first algorithm. Then I will write down, this is the second algorithm. Then I will say, and the third one. And lastly, there may be kind of a question. Is this the first algorithm with a question mark, right? No space here. So this is a list, right? If you print these sentences, so you find that you got a list of sentences. So anytime you can read a file, once you read a file, correct? So you get this sentences in the form of a list. Now, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna say your X is count vectorizer, right? Dot fit underscore transform these sentences. So the sentences which were the textual content, right, with the count vectorizer, this count vectorizer, this is the reference variable, right? So I can just make it like count vectorizer, more precise and informative. So you say fit transform, and now I'm gonna say print me the value of X. So when you run the program, so what you see is sum tuple 0 to 7 1 with the count 0 to 3 3 to 0. Now this information for us is a bit non-descriptive, right? That what exactly is what, right? So typically what happened, your words, they are converted into some numerical numbers now, right, with an algorithmic approach, of course. So what I will do is I will say analysis is your count vectorizer dot build an analyzer. So I don't know what exactly the things are, and you print me an analysis at the same time. So this is your analysis by which your kind of, you can say, sentences were transformed into your numbers or the vectors. And now I'm gonna say print me count vectorizer dot get the feature names, and I can even say print me x dot to array. So you can convert your words into numbers, and you can play around with your data sets. So here you are. So when I said get the feature names, so these feature names are like algorithm and first is one, second the, this, then the third, right? So let it be third. So what we see is that every single word has been converted into a list, and one hot encoding scheme is applied on your four sentences. So these four sentences are converted into one hot encoding model, and now you can actually play on your textual data sets as well. Guys, can I get a smiley here? So one of the key examples that how you can actually, you know, kind of work on your textual data sets. In case you have textual data sets, so this is the way how you can work with the help of count vectorizer APIs. So let me push this program. So we will try to figure out this. There is a small glitch in this data set. I'll try to refine it and share it with you. 49 was a priori algorithm. Then dimensionality reduction and feature extraction. So a bit of pre-processing on your data sets. So there is one more ML model which is kind of left so far. So that ML model is going to be a logistic regression that we'll see in our next session. And one small announcement to make here. So from Monday, we'll have the sessions at 10 a.m. in the morning. The internet speeds are a bit compromised in the late hours, and I have a couple of more batches to proceed with, guys. So now you can raise your queries in case. So Shimpa had this query select from model. So Shimpa select from model is going to work on random forest model. So where you have these 50 trees who are going to come up and kind of extract the importance in the feature, right? Every feature is going to have an importance based on the algorithms called Gini index, chi square, information gain, entropy. So based on that, anyone, right, it is going to give us which feature has more importance. So the features with more importances will be automatically taken into consideration and rest of the features will be removed, and hence your dimensionality will be reduced. In this 49C, I think that was the query. So this fit of X and Y is going to be an ML model for us, right? So this fit of X and Y is machine learning to extract the feature which are important. So prefit is what exactly, Shimpa? What is your query here with the prefit? All right, guys. So anyone else having any query? So Abhishek, Arshdeep, Gagan, Hitali, Jabjeet, Jasnoor, Manmeet, Navjot, Neha, Palvi, Pradeep, Roopkaval, Saib Noor, Sahil, Shashi, Shimpa, guys. So Shimpa, you need to be a bit more meaningful. You can just text me over this, right? So I didn't get your query at all here. Okay, Pradeep says, threshold. So Pradeep, threshold is a number, right, on which you are going to come up and decide that, okay, we want the results beyond this. So Shashi says, how the important of item is decided. So Shashi, let's assume the decision tree classifier, right? So what you are doing in the decision tree, you are finding the meaning, the information gain in every single attribute, right? And then you are placing the attribute in the root of the tree based on the information gain. So it's the same story. Which attribute has which, what, how much information? Based on that, you are going to come up and select the feature. So good to go, Shashi. So this is printing out, right? So this feature underscore importance is printing out these percentages for us, right? So these two will be picked up, these two will be discarded. Right, so these two gonna picked up and these two will be discarded for us. All right, guys, so this is all for the day, and Monday the session will be at 10 a.m. session shall be at 10 a.m. from Monday. All right, guys, thank you guys, bye-bye.